I will start with our most important source of revelation. If we want to ask, if we want to find out how did the universe come into existence, since nobody has been there when this happened, we have to study and read what God Himself revealed in the first chapters of Genesis. Therefore, I want to read together with here the revelation about how God created the stars, the moon, the sun, and all in the universe. It's in Genesis 1, 14 to 19, and later then we will examine how the church fathers, how the church has always understood these sentences, and how this has been challenged by a new theory. Then God said, "Let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons, and for days and years. And let them be for lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth." And it was so. God made the two great lights, the greater light to govern the day, and the lesser light to govern the night. He made the stars also. God placed them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, and to govern the day and the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. There was evening, and there was morning, a fourth day. How have these sentences been understood by the Church Fathers throughout history? I come with my first witness, Saint Ephrem the Syrian, who commented on Genesis 1, "Although both the light and the clouds were created in the twinkling of an eye, still both the day and night of the first day continued for 12 hours each." And he writes in another work, "Likewise, the moon, when it was created, was both old and young. It was young, for it was but a moment old. But it was also old, for it was as full as it is on the 15th day." So now we have already heard about two very important aspects of the traditional Catholic doctrine of creation of the universe. First, it was instantaneously, in a twinkling of an eye, and second, God can create things in a mature state. Remember what Hugh Owen said about the wine at the wedding of Cana? It's made complete, and for somebody who wants to explain everything by natural processes, this would give the impression that it was very old. But here Saint Ephrem the Syrian says, no, it was not old, it just gives the impression, in the example of the moon, as if it was already older than we see it. Saint Ambrose, when he commented on Genesis, he said, he, Moses, did not look forward to a late and leisurely creation of the world out of a concourse of atoms. So he was already confronted with a materialistic view of the development of the cosmos from atoms creating the universe by themselves. And he said that this is not what the Genesis account wants to report to us. He continues, "And fittingly, Moses added, he created, lest it be thought that there was a delay in creation. Furthermore, man would also see how incomparable the Creator was, who completed such a great work in the briefest moment of his creative act, so much so that the effect of his will anticipated the perception of time." So again, the important element of an immediate creation. And Saint Athanasius, in his four discourses against the Arians, "As to the separate stars or the great lights, not this appeared first and that second, but in one day and by the same command, they were all called into being." And he continues, "And such was the original formation of the quadrupeds and of birds and fishes and cattle and plants. No one creature was made before another, but all things subsisted at once, together, from one and the same command." Of course, each category of creatures at its distinct day, but not over billions of years. Let's move to another witness of how to interpret Genesis 1 and the description of the creation of the universe. The church councils, we have already heard this morning, this very important definition of the Council of Lateran IV in the 13th century, which was exactly repeated by Vatican I in the year 1817. So more than almost 11 years after the publication of Darwin's book, Origin of Species. And this applies both for biological creatures as the universe in itself, because it says, God, creator of all visible and invisible things, of the spiritual and of the corporeal, who by his own omnipotent power, not by natural processes, by omnipotent power, at once, simultaneously, from the beginning of time, not after billions of years of an evolutionary process, created each creature from nothing, spiritual and corporeal, namely angelic and mundane, and finally the human, constituted as it were the life of the spirit and of the body. And as a third witness, the doctors of the church. Saint Bonaventure in Praevilobium, we must specifically hold that physical nature was brought into existence in 6 days. And he talks about the perfection of this creation. He starts with the final perfection, which is the end of the whole universe. It is the perfect beatitude of the saints at the consummation of the world. And the first perfection is the completeness of the universe at its first founding. And this is what is ascribed to the seventh day. So we see here the important element that there was the order of creation, which was complete at day seven, and it was not an ongoing cosmic and biological evolution. No, there was then the order of nature as we observe it today, which doesn't introduce new kinds of creatures. Everything was complete. The summary, very short summary, underlines that in the works of nature, there is no creation, and in the works of creation, there is no natural process going on. It was purely supernatural. Or another way of formulating this important distinction, which all the fathers and doctors shared throughout history. So therefore, it is impossible for any creature to create, either by its own power or instrumentally, that is, ministerially. Now this is just the opposite formulation of what Théa de Chardin formulated. He summarized his teaching in the short formula, God created creatures in such a way that they themselves can create. St. Thomas rejects this view because the power to create belongs only to God, and we cannot give divine power to matter. We cannot attribute this to matter, that would divinize matter. It would result in a pantheistic view of the world. Let me give a brief overview of these important elements of the Catholic doctrine of creation of the universe. God created the universe and also the earth, life and man, each instantaneously, not over billions of years. And all church fathers held that the natural processes did not take part in creation. It was purely supernatural, and creation was finished, complete after creation week, and only since then the natural processes are at work. Now we have seen that this beautiful doctrine of creation has been attacked, and this attack has been predicted many centuries before it happened. It was predicted by St. Peter in his second letter, chapter 3, where he said that the scoffers will come who, as their main idea, will affirm that all things have continued as they were from the beginning of creation, meaning that the natural processes operated already from the beginning of creation, and they did what was usually thought God did. But he continues, they deliberately ignore this fact that by the word of God, not by any natural process, heavens existed long ago, and an earth formed out of water and by means of water, through which the world that then existed was deluged with water and spirit. And René Descartes is the one who was the first great, first famous theological thinker, Catholic thinker, who realized this prediction when he said, it is an opinion commonly received by the theologians that the action by which he, God, now preserves it, the world, is just the same as that by which he first created it. And he goes on, he describes already something which is very similar to the modern day Big Bang theory. He says, in his same discourse on the method, in this way, although he had not to begin with given this world any other form than that of chaos, provided that the laws of nature had once been established, and that he had lent his aid in order that its action should be according to its wont, we may well believe, without doing outrage to the miracle of creation, that by this means alone, all things which are purely material might in course of time have become such as we observe them to be at present. So from chaos to order, God created only one thing, the natural laws, and maybe a few molecules, and let them do everything what we see, and let them create everything on their own. And he says, and their nature is much easier to understand when we see them coming to pass little by little in this manner, then were we to consider them as all complete to begin with. So you see this complete rejection of the traditional Catholic doctrine of creation. And the one who followed this teaching, who built on this foundation in the realm of cosmology, is Georges Lemaître, the Belgian priest who invented the Big Bang theory. In his famous paper, The Beginning of the World, from the point of view of quantum theory, published in Nature in 1931. He said that if we go back in the course of time, we must find fewer and fewer quanta until we find all the energy of the universe packed in a few, or even in a unique quantum, in a primeval atom. Stars, moon, sun, all we see concentrated in one little atom. How did he come to such an idea, which is so against our intuition? He used as a basis this natural process and extrapolated it very much, too much, as would seem reasonable. The process is the Doppler effect. You certainly all know what happens when an ambulance with its sound is approaching you and when it is receding from you. When it's coming closer to you, you hear the sound at a higher frequency. When it's moving away, the sound is at a lower frequency. Now the same applies for light sources. When a light source is receding from us, from the observer, we see the wavelength increased, or the frequency decreased. And a decreasing frequency of light corresponds to a shift in the color of this light. It looks more red. This is the famous redshift of light. It is an indication, not a proof, that the light source is moving away from us. And what does this have to do with cosmology? It's very simple. Just here an example how to measure it. You just need a prism, and you send a light beam through this glass body, and you will see that the light frequencies are banded according to its frequency. The different light beams are divided according to the frequency, and you can easily see how much is the contribution of red or blue and other colors. And you apply this to the starlight. When this was done, it was found that all the galaxies around us have a distribution of the frequencies, of the light frequencies, which is shifted towards the red compared to the same kind of light which we see in the laboratory when we analyze their frequencies. And certainly one hypothesis how to interpret this is that the galaxies are moving away from us and from each other. If this is done, then we can conclude that yesterday the galaxies were closer than they are today. And still back in time, 100 years earlier, they would still have been closer and closer and closer. And Lemaître did this extrapolation to the breaking point, is that it was always the same movement. It was always coming closer and closer and closer until we had everything concentrated in one atom in a so-called singularity. Nobody knows what that is. It's just some point in space and time which is beyond physics, and this is called Big Bang. You reverse the time arrow here in this diagram, you have the history of the universe. It starts with nothing, and nothing exploded. And this is another way of describing the history of the universe. It's the standard model of cosmology. This is a NASA image to instruct the public how the universe came into existence. On the left you see the famous so-called quantum fluctuation, the explosion of nothing. And this explosion was very rapid in the beginning, faster than the speed of light. And then it, after 400 million years, the first stars formed, according to this theory, and we had a continuous linear expansion of the universe, which is in later times followed by an accelerated expansion according to the redshift measurements. And in between, the stars arranged themselves in galaxies, clusters, superclusters, and produced the universe which we have today. And all of this lasted for 13.7 billion years. That's the age of the world according to this theory. And I will show now how you can calculate the age of the world based on these assumptions. It's very simple. If you take any star or galaxy which is receding from us, according to the interpretation, then from the redshift you can derive the velocity of this recession. And from its brightness, astronomers calculate the distance, which is another unproven assumption. There can be other factors which decrease the brightness, but that's the typical procedure. Now you have both. You have the velocity, you have the distance. And then you apply the simple law of motion, which is also applied for bicycles or airplanes, that a body which moves linear without acceleration, its distance is related to its velocity. By this equation, distance is equal to velocity times travel time. So now you can very easily calculate the travel time if you know distance and velocity from redshift and brightness. And when you do this, you arrive at 13.7 billion years. That's it. So simple is it to calculate the age of the world in the framework of the Big Bang theory. However, you must be careful. There is at least one unproven extrapolation in it. Extrapolation that always we had always the same movement since the beginning of creation. It's a prediction of St. Peter, which Georges Lemaître fulfilled. He did not include, or he did not consider that if it's really a movement, a receding movement, it could have been different in the past. It could have started at some time where the galaxies were already at a fixed position. Now, if you present such a theory, you need a proof. It's not sufficient to take a natural process and say, I extrapolated. And as the proof, the cosmic microwave background is usually presented. What is the microwave background? If you take a detector and look at the different areas in space, in the dark areas where there are no stars, you will find from all sides that there is a certain radiation, and it's in the microwave frequency range. The important thing here is that this radiation had been predicted by Big Bang cosmologists before it was discovered. Alpha and Hermann predicted it in 1948 in Nature. And they said that we should measure If the Big Bang theory is true, a background radiation corresponding to a temperature of 5 Kelvin. And almost 20 years later, it was discovered that there is really a background radiation and its temperature is 2.73 Kelvin. Now this was considered as a breakthrough for the Big Bang model. A prediction and almost an exact confirmation by the measurement. However, we must be careful. There are also other processes which predict such a microwave background radiation. And I will show you a few of them. This is the, on the y-axis you see the temperature of the microwave background. You see the prediction of the Big Bang theory, 5 Kelvin. And here you see the value which Wegener calculated more than 20 years before that. He used the energy of the cosmic particles, which he could measure, and calculated from that that there must be a cosmic microwave background with a temperature of 2.8 Kelvin. And in the same year, Arthur Eddington used the star radiation to calculate that there must be a cosmic background radiation with a temperature of 3.2 Kelvin. And Fred Hoyle observed the helium distribution in space, interpreted this as a product of nuclear fusion of hydrogen, and from this energy, he predicted that there must be a cosmic microwave background with a temperature of 2.78 Kelvin. And this is the measured value. So you see, we have three other predictions which were better than that of the Big Bang cosmology. That's why astronomer Bonnet Guidot, in his recent publication, comments, due to the lack of these basic confirmations, it's the cosmological character of the background radiation, that it has something to do with cosmic evolution, cannot be considered as proven today. Because of its very weak energy, it can be produced by a very large range of physical processes. Let's move on to other difficulties in the Big Bang cosmology. This is the chart published by the Harvard University on their website of reported measurements of the Hubble constant. What's the Hubble constant? It's just the quotient of velocity divided by distance of galaxies. So we have seen the age of the world is calculated by dividing distance by velocity. The Hubble constant is just the reciprocal of the age of the universe in this framework. You see that in the year 1930, we were informed that the Hubble constant amounts to 500 kilometers per second per megaparsec. And this corresponds to 2 billion years for the age of the cosmos. And later values have arrived at different conclusions. And finally, in the 1970s, the values seemed to converge at around 70 to 80 kilometers per second per megaparsec, which corresponds to these 14 billion years. And still, the scatter in these newer values is enormous. We have a discrepancy, a difference from the lowest to the highest values by 100%, giving ages of 10 billion years or 30 billion years. Now, the important point here is, obviously, in the 1930s until the 1960s, much of the measured redshift and brightness has nothing to do with velocity and distance. At least one of them must have come from other sources. This is what this chart proves. And this must be a reminder for us that, well, really, it's only an interpretation, this redshift as velocity and the brightness as distance. There can be other factors. Edwin Hubble himself was very reluctant in accepting this interpretation of Georges Lemaître. He was a real observational, empirical scientist. He did very much pioneering work in measuring redshifts. And he writes in The Realm of the Nebulae in 1936, "Careful examination of possible sources of uncertainties suggests that the observations can probably be accounted for if redshifts are not velocity shifts. If redshifts are velocity shifts, then some vital factors must have been neglected in the investigation? And what could be a source for the redshift instead of movement? He writes in the observational approach to cosmology, light may lose energy during its journey through space, and the loss of energy corresponds to a loss of frequency, a redshift. But if so, we do not yet know how this loss can be explained. So he speaks of tiring light. In its long journey, energy could be lost. Yeah. And then he continues in the same word. On the other hand, if the recession factor is dropped, if redshifts are not primarily velocity shifts, the picture is simple and plausible. And now in the following slides, I will show to you how many difficulties have arisen because we did not drop the recession factor and we extrapolated it to the breaking point as Georges Lemaître suggested it. What happened? What is the very fundamental objection against this naturalistic explanation of the universe? The most important one is the fact that the cosmos is anything else than a chaos. It's highly ordered, especially our surroundings. The beautiful planet Earth is so finely tuned in its position and in its composition that it cannot be the result of an exploding chaos. We have the ideal distance to the sun. If you were a bit closer, the water would evaporate. And if you were a bit further away, everything would freeze. Look at the other planets in our planetary system. There's no life possible. We have liquid water, dry land, we have all the elements necessary to allow for life, carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, hydrogen, and so on. We have relatively moderate seasons compared to what happens on Jupiter or Venus or Mars. And we do not have there heavy earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, radioactivity, poisonous chemicals, and so on. So this is a great support that there is an intelligent designer behind our Earth. But according to the naturalistic explanation, a chaos produced all that. And we know that the most fundamental natural law excludes any natural process that would produce order from disorder, since all proceeds from disorder, from order to disorder, never from disorder to order, sorry, from disorder to order is excluded by the second law of thermodynamics. I will talk about this more in detail tomorrow. Now, another important objection against this naturalistic idea of the emergence of the cosmos, the star formation theory. How did the stars come into existence? According to the Big Bang theory, in the beginning, very quickly, only a few hundred million years after the Big Bang, the cosmos was filled with gas clouds, nebulae. And due to their own gravity, these gas molecules were contracted so much that they became very hot and ignited as a star. However, there is one fundamental problem with that. There's also another force which is exercised on the gas molecules, that's gas pressure. Molecules tend to fly away from each other, this force is much stronger than gravity. An illustration is this aerosol. If you push the trigger, you will only observe that the gas goes out of the area of high pressure and moves where the pressure is lower. You will never observe the opposite, that by gravity or any other process, you can wait for billions of years, this gas will go back. But this is the big dilemma for the star formation theory. It's claiming just this. How have cosmologists tried to solve this difficulty? One suggestion was that perhaps there was a supernova explosion just in the vicinity of a gas cloud. And this could have produced a pressure wave which compressed the gas until it was contracted so much that it was held together gravitationally and ignited as a star. Another suggestion, perhaps there were cold particles in the vicinity of a gas cloud and they have been injected in the gas cloud, cooling it down very rapidly, and if you cool down the gas, it will be contracted. And in that way, we would have our compressed matter of a star. And the third idea, maybe there were two galaxies which collided, and in this collision, there was a huge pressure in the center which compressed the gas to form stars. Now, let's examine these three ideas. The first, with the supernova explosion. Can this be the explanation for the first star? Well, a supernova is a pre-existing star. It's an exploding star, so it cannot explain how the first star came into existence. Injected particles. Well, grains and particles can only be produced in a pre-existing star. So this is also ruled out. And the colliding galaxies causing compression. A galaxy is composed of pre-existing stars. So you see, it's true what Eva Novotny writes in her textbook Introduction to Stellar Atmospheres and Interiors. The process by which an interstellar cloud is concentrated until it is held together gravitationally to become a protostar is not known. And Martin Harvick, in a book review in Science in 1986, the silent embarrassment of modern astrophysics is that we do not know how even a single one of these stars managed to form. And another Science article in 1990, the origin of stars represents one of the most fundamental unsolved problems of contemporary astrophysics. So this is quite different from what the public always hears, that we have solved all the problems, we know how the universe and the stars and the planets and everything came into existence. The scientific literature tells a different story. We cannot explain the origin of stars by natural processes. So with this in mind, maybe next time you will look at the night sky with different eyes. It's really a witness of God's creative act. Also on that level, not only the universe as a whole, but also the celestial bodies. Another difficulty with the Big Bang theory, I called it the cosmic fossil record. You will see why. If the standard model were true, then we would have an opportunity to watch the past, to look into the past. Why that? If we looked at a star which is very far away, at the edge of the universe, then its light would have taken 13.7 billion years to reach our eyes if we are here in the center. Now, then what you would see would only be the tip of this light beam. And this tip was sent out when 13.7 billion years ago, at a time when the star was still young. So you would see the star in a young state. It's old light, but the star is in a young state, or the galaxy. What happens if we look at a nearby star? Then, also this star has sent out its light beam 13.7 billion years ago, but most of it would have passed our eyes, and we would see the last part of this light beam, which has been sent out recently, more recently, while the star or the galaxy was already very old. So we see it in a mature state, in a more advanced state. We should see a cosmic evolution if we go from near to far. But what do we see? With our most modern telescopes, we have reached more distant areas of the universe, and we found that the galaxies in the far away regions, in the young regions, look actually like those in the old regions, in the nearby regions. There is no cosmic evolution. This is against the prediction of the Big Bang theory. As Marcus Chown, a New Scientist, wrote in 2005, but there is a problem. We don't see young galaxies in the distant regions, says Lerner. We see old ones. They have pretty much the same range of stars as present-day galaxies. Another unexpected observation in the night sky, which contradicts the Big Bang calculations, the spiral rotation of many galaxies. We can measure the velocity of these rotations, and from very simple Newtonian gravitation laws, we know that if it were true that this spiral galaxy is rotated for billions of years, then the stars would be pulled out, pushed out. There would not be this structure anymore. It cannot last for such a long time. Now, one possible consequence of this would be to abandon the Big Bang theory. Another would be to say, perhaps there is much more than what we can see. There is additional matter around this structure, and this is keeping this whole thing together gravitationally. We don't know anything about this kind of matter. We only need it to maintain the Big Bang calculations. And this matter is called dark matter. So we gave it a name, but we have no idea what it is. Then, as I already indicated, recent redshift measurements, if interpreted as a movement, lead to the conclusion that the universe is not only in expansion, but in accelerated expansion. And if you want to accelerate something, you need a lot of energy, especially for the huge mass of the universe. But where do we get this energy from? The first law of thermodynamics says you can never create energy, you can only transform one form of energy in another. It was due to dark energy, the cosmologists tell us. So they invented a form of energy of which they have no idea what it is, but it is needed to maintain the Big Bang theory. Another important observation, which was unexpected. The cosmic microwave background is extremely homogeneous, too much for the calculations. If you, wherever you look in space, in each direction, you will find that the temperature differs by less than a 30 millionth of a Kelvin. Everywhere, perfect homogeneity. But the cosmologists tell us that the time when thermal equilibrium would have been possible was so late that the universe was already too big and light could not travel from one side to the other of the universe. Thermal equilibrium would not have been possible. So they could have discarded the Big Bang model, or they could have done what they actually did. They introduced a new process, an ultra-fast expansion called inflation, faster than the speed of light. Nobody knows what inflation is, where it came from, what drove it, but we need it in order not to give up the Big Bang theory because of these observations. But there's a new problem. If that is true, that everything is so homogeneous, how could it be that the galaxies are distributed so structured, in such a structured manner? They are ordered in clusters and superclusters. This is impossible if this background picture, which is an image of the early universe energy distribution, is so homogeneous. How can we solve this if we don't want to give up the Big Bang theory? We introduce dark matter again, because this would provide the gravity to arrange the galaxies in the clusters and superclusters as we see them. But there's a new problem. If there is so much dark matter introduced, then the calculations showed the expansion of the universe would be too weak, and the age could only be 8 billion years, not 13.7 billion years, as the redshift data suggests. How can we solve this problem? We need something which accelerates the movement. We need dark energy. So, certainly, this was too much for many. 33 leading scientists published an open letter to the scientific community in the journal New Scientist in 2004, where they write the following. The Big Bang today relies on a growing number of hypothetical entities, things that we have never observed. Inflation, dark matter, and dark energy are the most prominent examples. Without them, there would be a fatal contradiction between the observations made by astronomers, and the predictions of the Big Bang theory. In no other field of physics would this continual recourse to new hypothetical objects be accepted as a way of bridging the gap between theory and observation. It would, at the least, raise serious questions about the validity of the underlying theory. And this is a summary of this underlying theory. According to this model of the cosmological standard interpretation, only 4.6% of the universe is composed of atoms, protons, neutrons, electrons, as we know them. And we know that all around us is composed of it. If we want to explain how these things have emerged by natural processes, then we are forced to introduce 95% as additional objects, dark matter, dark energy, which we don't know what it is, which is not in the area of our scientific observation. Now this is very close to what the Church Father said. It is not possible to explain the emergence of the universe by natural processes. And the European Southern Observatory made an astonishing remark in the journal Spaceflight in 2004. This and many other recent astronomical observations point increasingly to the conclusion that a mature, active, evolving and expanding universe could have come into being in an instant creation, which is what St. Isaac the Syrian would agree. Maybe he would debate about whether there is an evolving and expanding movement, that's the redshift interpretation, but he would certainly argue, as all the Church Fathers, that God, solely by his good will, not by natural processes, suddenly, not over 13.7 billion years, brought everything, not just a few atoms in the beginning, from non-being into being. And everything stood before him in perfection. Now if you look back in history, we have had cultures that put celestial bodies in the status of a divinity. And in Mexico, for example, the Aztecs had the moon as their second highest god and the sun as their highest god. And we know that in Guadalupe, when Our Lady appeared, she made the Aztecs clear that she was higher than their second highest god, and since she was standing on him, and higher than the sun in front of which she was standing, so as higher than their highest god. While she herself, as she was praying, made it clear she is not God. And the Aztecs realized quickly what this was saying. So they turned away from their idea that nature itself is a divine entity. And it's now our time to do the same. We cannot attribute matter things which only belong to God, which is the power to create. I would therefore conclude with the psalmist of old, thou didst lay the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of thy hands. They will perish, but thou dost endure. They will wear out like a garment. Thou changest them like raiment, and they pass away. But thou art the same, and thy years have no end. Thank you for your attention.